good morning and a warm, if wet, welcome to St. Mary's today on this, the 17th Sunday after Trinity. We begin our service today with the hymn which the choir will sing for us, Light's Abode, Celestial Saint. Father eternal, giver of life. what we have thought, in what we have said and done, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We have wounded your love and marred your image within us. We are sorry and ashamed and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and lead us out of darkness to walk as children of light. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us stand to say together the glory. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless till they find their rest in you. Pour your love into our hearts and draw us to yourself, and so bring us at last to your heavenly city, when we shall see you face to face. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the first reading.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Let me sing for my beloved my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out a wine vat in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem, people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? Now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel. The people of Judah are his pleasant planting. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed. Righteousness, but heard a cry. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I will sing for us the anthem, I Lift My Eyes.
Mm-hmm. Reading from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. If anyone else has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew, born of Hebrews. As to the law, a Pharisee. As to zeal, a persecutor of the church. As to righteousness under the law, blameless. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings by becoming like him in his death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on towards the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said to the chief priests and the elders of the people, "Listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a winepress in it, built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his slaves and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, 'They will respect my son.' But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, 'This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance.' So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. Now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants?" They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at the harvest time." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes.' Therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they realized that he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds because they regarded him as a prophet. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Keep on that theme, and our lovely harvest flowers are still in church. The goods that we offered last week have been taken up to the food bank and will be distributed there to those in need. So the harvest, though, continues, and particularly our calling to take part in the Lord's harvest. And so today Jesus tells a story, a parable about the harvest. Parables, especially as told by Jesus, are interesting little devices, interesting little episodes that are scattered throughout the Gospels. Some of them are longer, more worked out. Perhaps the most famous one is the parable of the Good Samaritan that many of us will know. And that's a long and involved story as the Samaritan meets his three passers-by, the last of whom stops to tend his wounds, the last one who was the least expected. Some of those parables are much shorter, and throughout Matthew's Gospel that we heard from today, there are plenty of one-line parables. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, or is like a field that the man sold all that he had to buy because he knew that there was rich treasure to be found there. I wonder what happens to you as you listen to these parables. Do you find yourself drawn into them, identifying with one character or another? Today's parable is particularly suitable for that. We've got a number of different characters here. The landowner, the tenants, who are ploughing the fields and digging the vineyards. We've got the slaves sent to collect the produce. We've got the son at the end of the landowner, sent to collect the produce when the slaves are unable to extract their due. Do you find yourselves identifying with any of those characters in particular? And the good thing about parables is there's no right answer. You're not supposed to identify with anyone in particular. And on a different day, at a different time, in a different place, you may well find a different part of the story speaks to you. The Pharisees who were listening to that story, on that particular day, in that particular place, found that the story spoke to them. They realized that they were the tenants, that they were the ones to whom the land had been entrusted, but who had turned away, even killed, those who came to collect the fruits of their labor. Here, Jesus is talking to the Pharisees because they, the religious authorities of the time, had been entrusted with God's message, his good news, trusted to reveal his presence. But they were turning away those who came to hear that message, turning away and even persecuting, killing, as Paul admits in his letter, those who were spreading the good news. But as I say, we're not always meant to identify ourselves with the tenants. Perhaps we could be somebody else. Or perhaps, as Isaiah has it in his prophecy that we heard from today, perhaps we might not be a person, a character, at all. Isaiah identifies the people of Judah as God's pleasant planting. Perhaps, in fact, we're the vines. We're the ones growing. And that is how Jesus speaks in John's Gospel. He says, in fact, he is the vine and we are the branches. We're the ones connected to him, nourished by him and his word, his teaching, his love. We're the ones who grow because of his feeding. That means, in terms of the harvest and in terms of the fruitfulness, there are many ways that we might bear fruit. There are many ways that we might share that fruit. But we should be able to live out the kingdom, the gospel message in our lives, treating one another with love and patience, serving our neighbour in need, and proclaiming God's love to other people. We can do that only by being rooted and grounded in God, who is not only the landowner, but also the strong vine grown there. Let us stand to declare our faith in God in the words of the Lord. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God, the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray.
Pray for our Lord, we especially pray for those who, like St. Paul, have suffered.
Jerusalem the goal. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, from sunrise to sunset this day is holy. For Christ has risen from the tomb and scattered the darkness of death with light that will not fade. This day the risen Lord walks with your gathered people, unfolds for us your word, and makes himself known in the breaking of the bread. And though the night will overtake this day, you summon us to live in endless light, the never-ceasing Sabbath of the Lord. And so, with choirs of angels and with all the heavenly host, we proclaim your glory and join their unending song of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. And as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood, who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself, made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom. And with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Grace is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Accept through him, our great High Priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your Spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honour and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray together in confidence in the words that Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. I'll invite you forward to receive communion, and we'll start from this side and work our way round. Do keep your eye on Colin, who will assist you to come forward, just so that we can maintain that 2 metre distance wherever possible. Lord, we pray that your grace may always precede and follow us, and make us continually to be given to all good works. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We pray together. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Every 6 years, we have to scrap the electoral roll and come up with a new one. Last year, you may remember, was that year. So everyone who was on the electoral roll had to start from scratch and put their names forward to be on the new roll. We spoke about this a lot before lockdown. At the moment, we are aware that some of you that were on the old electoral roll are not on the new one. Now, this is particularly important because on the 19th of October, in a fortnight's time, we have our annual parochial church meeting. And if you would like to attend that, you need to be on the electoral roll. And also, if you would like to become a member of the PCC or hopefully a church warden, you also need to be on that. So today is actually the last day to get your name down to become a member of, to get on the electoral roll for this year. You can join the electoral roll at any time, but after today, you will not be able to have a say in the meeting in a fortnight's time. So, and also, just to remind you then, that anyone who wants to join the PCC or would like to, depending on the number of places, Diana will have the appropriate sheets for you to sign, and she will bring those in on Wednesday. But the sheets for the electoral roll are in the foyer if you'd like to sign for that. Today, we will be leaving after the service by the same door that you came in through because of the 11th Church in the community area. Now, on the 9th of October to the 15th, it is Baby Loss Awareness Week, and to that end there will be a service in the Church of St Peter and St Paul at Keddington at 7 o'clock on the 12th of October, a service for Baby Loss Awareness Week, where you'll be able to light a candle in the memory of all babies' lives gone too soon. That will be at 7 o'clock. And for anyone who hasn't had enough of church today, there is evensong at Horseheath this afternoon at 4 o'clock. I shall be going if anyone would like a lift. I think that's all I need to talk about. I just need to thank Richard and the choir for making our service what it is today, because being able to have the choir back, it makes this such a different service, and I'd like to thank Richard and the choir for that. And finally, just to thank Max for the lovely service today. Thank you.
Thank you, Colin. I know it is a frustration that congregations are still not able to sing. There is work ongoing to investigate whether that restriction needs to stay in place and what we might be able to do. But for the moment, as Colin says, we're very grateful to Richard and the choir for providing us with some musical accompaniment. And for all those who sing as well during the week on Wednesdays and on Fridays. Again, on that subject, it's worth noting that this weekend is a very special weekend for our Cafe Church and Elevenses communities. In other years, we might be having a little bit of a celebration. It is 10 years since in Evans's and Cafe Church was started up. So we're celebrating by bringing Evans's back into church, which is why we've closed off the community area so that we can keep those spaces distinct for the time being. But it's wonderful to know that those opportunities to bring new people into church and opportunities to gather, perhaps in a slightly more informal context, have been going on for the last decade. And we pray for their continuing mission and ministry and fellowship over the next, hopefully, 10 years and more. There's a good team at both services. So if anybody wants to come along and start helping out, you'd be very welcome. I'm sure Tracy wouldn't mind hearing from you about Friday.
Want to sing on Friday, let me know.
Lovely. It's and it's been a pleasure to be with you. So, thank you, Colin, for your words. 3 weeks in, and you haven't got rid of me yet, so I must be doing a reasonable job. Our choir will now sing for us our final hymn, Rejoice, the Lord is King. Love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.